The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We have a number of things going on. By the way, our acolytes, we had double our crowd last night because we had a couple of our young people choirs performing. So our acolytes were at that service. So when you see adults, we recruited adult acolytes today. So please note that in your bulletin is a insert about the WELCA thank offering. And I encourage you to put a thank offering in the, if you're going to make a thank offering, please put it in the offering plate. And we will have a prayer right after the offering is brought up that will bless both those thank offerings as well as our chest of pledges. We did that last week and we said we would do it this week also. Our gospel lesson, this is the last Sunday after Pentecost. Next Sunday is a festival called Christ the King, and whenever that happens, we jump way to the end and talk about the end. So we'll have a text that will talk about what happens, or at least both our second lesson and our gospel lesson tells us what we are to be doing while we wait for the end to happen. And that will be our theme. I think that's all. You'll notice we prayed for Selma Sardowski last week. That is Barbara Hover's mother. And she died Friday. We actually had the graveside service. Excuse me, she died Thursday evening. We had the graveside service Friday. Let's prepare our hearts for worship through the brief order of confession and forgiveness found on the third page of your bulletin. Please rise. In the name of God, the Father of glory. In the name of God, the Son, our Redeemer. In the name of God, the Holy and life-giving Spirit. Amen. The Son of Righteousness shall rise with shining beams of healing. Let us gather under the wings of God's mercy. Gracious God, we acknowledge that we are sinners and we confess our sins, those known to us that burden our hearts, and those unknown to us but seen by you. We know that before you nothing remains hidden, and in you everything is revealed. Free us from the slavery of sin. Liberate us from the bondage of guilt, and work in us that which is pleasing in your sight. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. With a heart full of mercy and compassion, God saves us and forgives us all our sins. Christ, the dawn from on high, shines upon us, and by the light of the Holy Spirit, guides our feet into the way of peace. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Share God's peace by greeting those around you. grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Lord, be with you.
Also with you.
O God, the protector of all who trust in you, without you nothing is strong, nothing is holy. Embrace us with your mercy, that with you as our ruler and guide, we may live through what is temporary without losing what is eternal. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
First lesson is from Malachi chapter 4. See, the day is coming, burning like an oven, when all the arrogant and all evildoers will be stubble. The day that comes shall burn them up, says the Lord of hosts, so that it will leave them neither root nor branch. But for you who revere my name, the Son of Righteousness shall rise with healing in its wings. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
The second lesson is from 2 Thessalonians. Now we command you, beloved, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, to keep away from believers who are living in idleness and not according to the tradition that they received from us. For you yourselves know how you ought to imitate us. We were not idle when we were with you, and we did not eat anyone's bread without paying for it. But with toil and labor, we worked night and day, so that we might not burden any of you. This was not because we do not have that right, but in order to give you an example to imitate. For even when we were with you, we gave you this command: anyone unwilling to work should not eat. For we hear that some of you are living in idleness, mere busybodies, not doing any work. Now such persons we command and exhort in the Lord Jesus Christ to do their work quietly and to earn their own living. Brothers and sisters, do not be weary in doing what is right. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel according to Saint Luke. The 21st chapter. When some were speaking about the temple, how it was adorned with beautiful stones and gifts dedicated to God, Jesus said, "As for these things that you see, the days will come when not one stone will be left upon another. All will be thrown down." They asked him, "Teacher, when will this be, and what will be the sign that this is about to take place?" And he said, "Beware that you are not led astray, for many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and the time is near. Do not go after them. When you hear of wars and insurrections, do not be terrified, for these things must take place first, but the end will not follow immediately." Then he said to them, "Nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes, and in various places famines and plagues, and there will be dreadful portents and great signs from heaven. But before all this occurs, they will arrest you and persecute you. They will hand you over to synagogues and prisons, and you will be brought before kings and governors because of my name. This will give you an opportunity to testify. So make up your minds not to prepare for your defense in advance, for I will give you words and a wisdom that none of your opponents will be able to withstand or contradict. You will be betrayed even by parents and brothers, by relatives and friends, and they will put some of you to death. You will be hated by all because of my name, but not a hair of your head will perish. By your endurance, you will gain your souls." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. I would like to invite the children to come up. Help me with the stage. Yeah. Well, good morning. It's been a long time since we have had a puppet sermon at this service. And we're going to see two puppets. We're going to see Dewey. He's the little ball-headed guy. And we're going to see the turkey, okay? And they're going to mention a word, and that word is weary. Anybody know what that word is, means? Well, listen, because afterwards I'm going to ask you if you caught what it meant, all right?
Do, 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 do. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks. I love to sing. Well, hi, Turkey.
Hi, Dewey. Come on, Dewey, can I ask you a question?
Ask away.
Do you think I'm weary?
Weary?
You know, tired.
Tired? Do you mean sleepy tired?
No, not just tired. Tired of doing stuff. Tired of helping. Tired of being good.
Do you mean even tired of doing good?
Yeah. Like, even tired of doing good things for other people.
Well, no. I don't think of you as being weary.
Dewey!
Yes, Turkey?
Are you weary?
Do you mean tired of doing good?
Yes. Tired of serving.
No. I don't think I'm weary. God loves me. I love God. I want to serve.
Then pick up a white basket in the back of the church and work on your reverse Advent calendar.
But it's not Advent yet.
Just do it! Sometimes you make me weary.
I think I will enjoy it. Say, let's sing. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks. Because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks. He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks.
Give thanks.
That's all, folks.
What does weary mean? Ethan. No. Andrew, very good. Being tired. Tired. Tired of doing good. And the Apostle Paul told the church in Thessalonica that they should never grow weary or be tired of doing good. So we've got a good thing for you to do. See this? It's a basket, and there's a bunch of baskets in Mission Hall, and it has an Advent calendar. Each day, you can open a page, and the idea is, it tells you what you're supposed to do here. And then what you're supposed to do is every day put in a can of food or a box of food, and it tells you what to do. And by December 24th, you'll have this basket full, and it even tells you when to bring it back. And if people want to just put money in rather than cans and boxes of food, they can do that. But pick one up. It'll be a good discipline for Advent, and you need never tire of doing good. Okay, let's pray. Repeat after me. Gracious God, we thank you for your love. It gives us strength. So that we never tire of doing good. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You can go back to your seats. Thank you. I think Scott made a very good turkey. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. By the way, we had a text about the end of the world. Some people thought after Tuesday it was the end of the world.
Amen.
But those that think it's a bad thing, it's never as bad as you think. And those that think it's a good thing, it's never as good as you think. We'll still be muddling through things, I'm sure, for the next 4 years. I'm no fun, right? Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Name of this sermon is If, Because, Regardless. Our gospel lesson and 1 Thessalonians deal with the end of time, and both give suggestions on what to do while we wait. And we're going to look at, in particular, 1 Thessalonians. We begin with a mindless story, and let's make it a Sven and Ole story. Workers in a factory, and of course, Sven and Ole are always trying to find ways of getting out of work. So Sven says to Ole, I know how we can do that. And Ole says, oh, how? Sven climbs up, scales across the rafters in the factory, and hangs by his knees upside down. And the boss comes in and sees Sven up there, and he says, why are you up there? And Sven says, I'm a light bulb. And the boss says, well, you get down from here right now. I can see you need a break. Take the rest of the week off. So as Sven is walking out the factory, he's followed by Ole. And the boss says to Ole, where are you going? And he says, I can't work in the dark. In our second lesson, we have people who do not want to work. By the way, this is a joke about the pilgrims. So when do we eat, says the one pilgrim sitting there. Of course, we would think, no, not our pilgrims. What's happening in the Thessalonian church? The Thessalonian church, Apostle Paul had to give them the admonition that some of you are not working, and if you do not work, you do not eat. Here's what's happening. We'll take and he finally says, do not grow weary of doing good. The Thessalonian church, Paul founded, you can find that in Acts 17. He left Philippi, he was chased out of Philippi, and he founded the church in Thessalonia. But he could not stay there very long, and he just got it started. It was a synagogue church, and then a number of God-fearing Greeks and not a few prominent women were members. And then they claimed, their detractors claimed, that they were saying that there is a king other than Caesar, which is, of course, against the law. Riots ensued. Persecution ensued. So they needed a word of encouragement from the Apostle Paul. And 1 Thessalonians, when he wrote 1 Thessalonians, they also read in there some statements the Apostle Paul made about the end of time, and they felt that the end of time was imminent, going to happen any day. So if it's the end of time is imminent, why work? So as a consequence, some threw in the towel. Oh, that's supposed to be towel. Quit jobs, led undisciplined lives. So Paul's correction is, don't give up. Live life for the long haul. Don't grow tired. Don't grow weary of doing good. So, what's your motivation for doing good? Christine Wicker interviewed a man by the name of Vincent Hall. Vincent Hall was known in the Dallas-Fort Worth area as being the president of the board of a credit union that was quite prominent in that area. And he was also known for being a Christian. And he said he heard a sermon by his pastor that told about people having three different motivations for serving. And those motivations were if, because, regardless. So what's your motivation for doing good? If, dear God, if you bless me and reward me, I will serve. We all do that to a degree, don't we? Oh, my life will be blessed, or at least I hope. Dear God, bless my life if I serve. An interesting statistic is that almost 50% of the charitable giving in the United States is given by people who make less than $30,000 a year. Almost 50%. Isn't that incredible? Do you think they give? If God, you bless my life? If. Because. I'm suggesting that if should not merely be our only motivation. In fact, that should be a tertiary motivation, our last motivation. Because. Dear God, because you have blessed me and rewarded me, I will serve. It's a story I haven't told about my father. You may not know it, but my father was a hero. A hero, at least in the eyes of Mr. Belland. Remember one night coming home from confirmation, it was dark out, and Mr. Belland had been plowing his field. He had 20 acres of cultivated land near us. When we got home, it was dark out. You could hear off in the distance, it sounded like someone yelling. And I know my mother said, come out here and listen. And we couldn't tell if it was someone yelling or if it was Mrs. Einem's peacock. And my mother goes, well, I wish your father were home. And finally, my father came home and he says, oh, that is someone yelling out there. And my mother's going, don't go, George, that's dangerous, don't go. But my father said, no, I've got to go. Call the police. So he went out there, and Mr. Belland, the way Mr. Belland told the story to me, he said, my tractor was there trapping me. It was falling on me. It was a very hilly piece of land, very steep hills. And somehow when he made a turn, the tractor started tipping. My father said he foolishly jumped underneath it to save his tractor, and he's risking his own life. So he's laying there, and the tractor is, he can't hold it up, and it's slowly falling on him, and he was certain that it was going to crush him. My father found a big log and started helping pry it up, and they were getting it, and they almost got it to that balance point where it would tip. When the police officer, a big burly guy, came by, he said, oh, let me give you a hand, and he pushed it to the top. Well, Mr. Belland came the next day to our house. My father wasn't home. I think I was the only one that was home. It was after school. And he had a sack of potatoes on his shoulder. And he told me the story of how my father saved his life. And I said, I don't have much to give. The Bellands were poor people. But I just want to give something. Please give this sack of potatoes to your father. My father gets home and I say, Dad, look at that sack of potatoes. Mr. Belland brought it over for saving his life. I'm thinking it's not such a great gift, right? And my father says, wow, from Mr. Belland? And he got on the phone immediately. I've never met the man before. My father gets on the phone and calls him up and says, hey, thank you for the potatoes. And my father said to me, it had to mean a lot to him to give such a gift. But you see, Mr. Belland was giving. Why? Because my father saved his life. Now, do we give because? Sure. Because of what God has given us? Sure. But that's not our only motivation. Remember, 50%, almost 50% of the charitable giving in the United States is given by people who make $30,000 or less a year. $30,000 or less. They're not giving because they're giving, though. When Vincent Hall was interviewed, he said there's a third kind of giving that my pastor talked about, and he called it regardless. People who give regardless of whether or not they've received anything. And Vincent Hall said, ever since I heard that sermon, I wanted to be a regardless giver. Why? He said, I want to be so caught up in the love of God that I want to give regardless. I want to serve, I want to follow out of love. Isn't that what Jesus said when he talked about the end of time? He said, mother will be against daughter, son against family, Even your families will turn you in. You will be persecuted. Some of you will die. But Jesus is asking them to follow. Why? They should be so caught up in the love of God that they want to serve. They want to give. They want to follow for the sake of love. So we're called today. We're called today to love. We're called today to serve and follow, but we're called to be loved so that we can serve and love. I'll just end with this bumper sticker. Remember the bumper stickers a few years ago that said, "Visualize world peace"? And the bumper sticker I saw this week, "Forget world peace, visualize using your turn signal." It doesn't take big things. Just focus on the little things. Serving, following God, and the little things filled with His love. Amen. Thank you.
Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe
in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
With the people of God gathered here and throughout the world, we offer our prayers for the church, those in need, and all of creation. God, who made all things good, you create us to be caretakers and stewards in your creation. You equip us to provide for the people, places, and ministries that you have entrusted to our care.
Draw us together in the light of faith and hope, so that we may recognize our calling to this work. Lord, in your mercy.
God, who blesses our labor, on this day that we give thanks with the women of the ELCA, we thank you that you light our paths with the histories of women who acted boldly on their faith to change the world.
Bring their influence to our attention and their stories to our lips and ears. May we see in them our own potential to live boldly. Lord, in your mercy.
For our country after the election, we pray for a peaceful, orderly transition of power. Heal the divisions and rancor.
We pray for all of our leaders, old and newly elected, that they work for equity and for those unemployed and underemployed workers and their supporters. Lord, in your mercy.
God, our healer, we pray for those who hunger or thirst, for those who doubt or are terrified, for those who suffer in mind, spirit, or body.
Send your healing presence to all in need, especially Jeannie Burnell Graves, Carolyn Callen, Kelsey Cooper, Jaden Cullors, Laura Connor, Jana Everett, Michelle Farley, Sophia Fledgley, Mary Lou Fisher, Lou Graves, Jesse Hansen, Grant Hayden, Doug Holbein, Dennis Holmes, Vera Kimsey, Janet Littlecrow, Chris Marquardt, Wayne Myers, Lori Pettit, Sean Snellen, Chris Snyder, Rita St. Jimmy, Lucy Stilwell, Paul Thompson, Bonnie Turner, Rod West, Bennett Wilkerson, Marietta Young, and Kathy Zinter. Are there any others?
We give thanks for men and women of every time and place who have died in Christ, and whose examples of faithful living we follow.
We remember especially Randy Greenwood and Shelma Sadowski. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, you have promised to hear those who call upon your name. We commend all our spoken and silent prayers to you, trusting in your abundant mercy, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. box for pledges in the back. God of grace, you have showered us with abundance and entrusted to us the mission and ministry of Messiah Lutheran Church and the ministries of the women of the ELCA. Accept these faithful commitments, these pledges, to further your mission and ministry among us. Multiply them to meet the needs of your mission and ministry among us. Accept these thank offerings to further your mission in and through the women of the ELCA. Help us to grow in faith, affirm our gifts, support one another in our callings, engage in ministry and action, and promote healing and wholeness in the church, the society, and the world. Accept these gifts and this prayer that, nurtured by your word, filled with your spirit, and fed at your table, we may share with gladness all that you have shared with us until all creation is satisfied. Amen.
Let us pray. Merciful God,
right.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death in the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. All is ready. Our Lord invites us. Please come. You may be seated.
Thank you.
body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
We give you thanks, Shepherding God, that you have gathered your scattered flock again this day, feeding us richly with the food of paradise. Accompany us as we serve you all the days of our lives, and gather us with the saints in the day of our death, through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer and Lord.
We have a few announcements, so those wishing to make announcements, please come forward. Let me just tell you an announcement about the Christmas tree. Yes, we already have a Christmas tree. It comes from Lutheran Family and Children's Services, and each of the ornaments has a little tag with it that tells you who you are adopting. I don't know if it has a name, but it has a list of things that this person needs. They are foster children. If you know, Greene County has more foster children, Southwest Missouri, than any other part of the state. And it shows you gifts that you can give, and up to $50 they want you to spend. So if you're interested in taking one of those, please do. We had 10. First time we've ever done it, so I thought, well, we'll take 10. 8 went last night. So overnight, they brought 10 more. So anyway.
Pastor Dan did a great job of explaining the reverse Advent calendar projects, but I just want to make sure that everybody knows they're not just for families with smaller children. They're for singles, for couples, for anybody who wants to help your neighbor in need. We'll be out in the back in Mission Hall if you'd like to pick up yours and be involved in a need outreach during Advent.
And a third opportunity to serve those in our community at Christmas time who may not have the means to provide the kind of celebration they'd like to for their families. Over the next nearly 4 weeks, once again, we'll be collecting toys for the Crosslines Toy Store. This effort provides Christmas to thousands of children in our community every year. Once again, we'll be adopting teen children. So over the next 3.5 weeks, please be bringing those things that you've purchased. There'll be a spot out here next Sunday, and also a sign-up sheet where you can join the group from Messiah that will assist with the distribution that takes place on Saturday, December 17th. Thanks.
Thank you, Bruce. Dan.
Perhaps you were already going to mention the Pi Social that follows the Thanksgiving Eve service. I would like to add this. It is more than a Pi Social. It has been for many, many years. Any kind of dessert is welcome. Adults tend to like pies, but I guarantee you the little ones get more excited over the brownies and things like that. So feel free to bring whatever. Should you not be familiar with that tradition, I wanted to make sure you did.
Glad you mentioned the Pi Social, which what precedes it is possibly more important, or is more important, our Thanksgiving Eve worship service, 7 o'clock on that Eve before Thanksgiving, which I don't know the date. Receive this benediction. Yes. Oh, yes. Right after this, we want you all to stay because we need a quorum for our congregational meeting in which we will elect people to the church council. All right. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Oh, one last thing. Lou Graves is going up to Hannibal, Missouri, and we won't see her for the next few months. She's going to go up there and get some therapy. We're not going to do a farewell and Godspeed because we expect her back. But express your goodbyes to Lou.
Peace, remember the poor.
Thanks be to God.